So we'd like, good evening everyone.
Good evening.
I'd like to invite everyone to please rise. We are going to the most important part of the service this evening.
Amen.
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 The preaching of the word. Amen. I'd like to invite everyone to please open your Bibles to the book of 1 Thessalonians 1:10. 1:10. I have handouts here, but it's not. I have also brought my PowerPoint so that I make sure na hindi na magtatagumpay ang kaaway sa gabi nito. Pinaksalt ko na po talaga siya. Sobra-sobra. 1 Thessalonians 1, verse 1 to 10. Let's read this one all together. Are you there? Say amen.
Amen.
But you have to make sure that you are reading it in the King James Version. Amen?
Amen.
Amen.
Let's read it all together. If you are there. 1 Thessalonians 1:1. Paul and Silvanus. Let's read all together, please. Paul and Silvanus and Timotheus and to the church of the Thessalonians, which in God the Father and in the Lord Jesus Christ, grace be unto you and peace from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ. We give thanks to God always for you, Jew. Remembering without ceasing your work of faith, labor of love, and patience, hope of our Lord Jesus Christ, in the sight of God our Father, knowing, brethren, beloved, your election of God. Spirit and truth. We pray, O God, that you grant your servant this evening the wisdom and the knowledge to impart the message that you prepared for us to preach and the message that you want your sons and daughters to be blessed this evening. Lord, I pray that you hide me behind your back. Use me as your mouthpiece so that only be your name be preached this evening, O God. I pray for your sons and daughters that you give them a listening heart and a humble heart, O God. And I pray that may you give us the wisdom and the knowledge to understand the message that you wanted us to understand this evening. All these things we pray in Christ's most precious name. Amen. Please be seated. Good evening, church.
Good evening.
Do you have your handouts with you? I hope you have your handouts with you. This evening, you can see on your notes, you can see on your notes that our theme for this month is constrained by the love of Christ to wait upon His return. Last Friday, we heard a message entitled, How Will Jesus Find Us When He Returns? Amen?
Amen.
When I was preparing the message, I had some difficulty starting the message and finishing it. But I just pray to God for knowledge, that I just hope that He will enlighten me so that I can share a message to each and every one of you that will be a blessing. But God indeed was really very faithful that He not only gave me a message entitled, How Will Jesus Find Us When He Returns? But He was able as well to give me another message, a sequel to that message, that if we are challenged last Friday on how will Jesus find us when He returns? It was a challenge for each and every one of us, but the question after that is that, what to do next? So I was really very blessed because through the message that I prepared, I was enlightened by our God to expound it further so that I have come out with a message that you have in your notes this evening entitled, How to Prepare for the Second Coming. The message I want to bring with you this evening was coming from the book of 1 Thessalonians, the letter of Paul to the Thessalonians, wherein I tried to study a lot of books in the Bible when I was preparing this because I was given an ample time to prepare a month further, earlier. But this is the only book that I found that the 1 Thessalonians was the only book, was the only example in the New Testament that believers were preparing for the imminent return of Jesus, of our Lord Jesus Christ. On this book, you can find it in 1 Thessalonians that most of the chapter of the book, every chapter actually of this book was ending in the thoughts of the second coming. So I have prayed to God that Lord, please give me a wisdom to understand it further. So I was being convicted to share with you the 1 Thessalonians 1, chapter 1 to 1 to 10. That this book speaks particularly for us to be prepared when the rapture or the training for the second coming of our Lord Jesus Christ. This book was showing the need to be awakened to the urgency and emergency of the soon upcoming of our Lord Jesus Christ. Amen? I have prepared around 4 to 5 points this evening, around like 5 points this evening. But most of this was coming from the first, on the preaching that I did last Friday. And the first point I want to share with you this evening was about how to prepare for the second coming of Christ, of our Lord Jesus Christ. Was first part is that this is the verse that we have read. And the first point I want to share with you is that we need to be serving. In order for us to be prepared for the second coming, what are the things that we need to do? I have come with 5 points in order for us to be prepared for the upcoming, for the arrival of our Lord Jesus Christ. The first point is that we need to be servant. We need to be servant. We have heard last Friday a challenge on how to prepare, but this evening I will be sharing with you the first sub-point I want to share with you is that we need to be serving. In 1 Thessalonians 1 verse 3, we can find from there, remembering without ceasing your work of faith and labor of love, patience of hope in our Lord Jesus Christ in the sight of God and our Father. Remembering without ceasing your work of faith. Work of faith. The first sub-point I want to share with you is that the practice of faith. The practice of faith. In James chapter 2, verse 14 to 26, please flash the verse, Brother Chester. James chapter 2, verse 14 to 26. This is about the verse that talks about faith. You can see from this that the Thessalonians were serving and they are practicing their faith. The Word of God says the work of faith. Brothers and sisters, we are not saved by works and faith. Amen?
Amen.
We are not saved by works and faith. In Ephesians 2, 8 to 9, for by grace are ye saved. Amen?
Amen.
Through faith and not of yourselves. First Thessalonians, I'm sorry for that, Brother Chester, James chapter 2, 14 to 26, let's read it. The Bible says, what doth it profit, my brethren, Though a man say he doth not faith and have not works, can faith save him? Continue. If a brother or sister be naked and destitute of daily food, and one of you say unto them, depart in peace, be ye warm and filled, notwithstanding ye give them for not those which are needful to the body, what doth it profit? Even so faith, if it hath not works, is dead, being alone. Yea, a man may say, thou hast faith, and I have works. Show me thy faith without thy works, and I will shew thee my faith by my works. Apostle Paul is saying that, can we go back to that verse, Brother Chester? I'll show me thy faith without thy works, and I will shew thee my faith by my works. The Bible is saying, brothers and sisters, that it is impossible for a believer to say and profess that he or she is a Christian and you don't produce any good works. It's easy for a Christian to say that, Brother Ian, I'm a Christian. I believe in Jesus Christ. I am saved. Very good. But the question here for us this evening is that, are you living like a Christian? Are you living the way or living a life like a Christian? It's easy for us to be a Christian. It's easy for us to say we are a Christian. But are we living and are we walking the talk that we are telling that we are Christians? This is the point what this Apostle Paul is telling us, that we are saved by faith that works. Paul said, show me your faith without your works. And the book of James says, and I will show you my faith by my works. Amen? Amen? We are saved by faith that works, brothers and sisters. You and I need to be serving if we are going to be ready when our Lord Jesus Christ is going to return. Amen?
Amen.
It is impossible for us to say that we are Christian and we don't do good works. We can do good works even if we are not a Christian, right? I have known a lot of individuals, I have known a lot of persons, I have known a lot of famous persons, they do charities. But after they do charities, they go back to their old life, they do what the flesh is telling them to do. But if you are a Christian, you have to do and act and live like a Christian.
Amen.
The Bible says in Luke chapter 6 verse 43, for a good tree bringeth not forth corrupt fruit, neither doth a corrupt tree bring forth good fruit. I remember my father used to tell me that, Ian, a man good tree, when it bringeth forth fruit, it will not bring it an avocado fruit. Right? May nakita na po ba kayo na mangga na namunga ng avocado? Imposible po mangyari yan. Kasi ang mangga, mamumunga ng mangga. If you are not a Christian, it is easily to be justified that you are doing bad things. Because you are not a Christian. But if you are a Christian, the Bible says the practice of faith, you should be doing good works. Not because you are a Christian, because inside you, God changed you already. Amen?
Amen.
The practice of faith, a true Christian will produce good works and good results. Amen? That is what is the Bible is telling in this passage, that we need to be serving, but we need to practice of faith. Amen? And the second sub-point is that the price of faith. In 1 Thessalonians 1:3, it says again, that remembering without ceasing your work of faith and labor of love. Marami po ang may gusto ng labor. Ay marami ang may gusto ng love, pero walang labor. Yung mga anak, ito po yung labor. I remember my wife, when she is giving birth to my third son, my only son, I'm still in the reception, I can hear my wife shouting in the delivery room. She is not shouting my name, but she's telling to please open me up. They have a term for the nurses, na instead of going for normal, ECS na lang daw siya. Because of pain. Everyone wants love, but they don't want labor. But in the book of 1 Thessalonians chapter 1 and 3, the Bible says, Paul is commending the Thessalonians for their what? Without ceasing, your labor of love. Amen? The Bible says in Hebrews 6:10, what does the Bible says? For God is not unrighteous to forget your work and labor of love, which ye have showed toward His name, that in that ye have ministered to the saints and do minister. Our God is not blind, and our God is not insensitive not to know what you are doing for His work. Amen? God knows each and every effort that you are doing for His ministry. The Bible says labor of love. You see a slave worker? You see a slave works? How does a slave work? If you will go back to the Israelites when they were in Israel, they are working hard work because they are slaves. You see, a slave works because he has to work, right? Compulsory. Otherwise, if he stops, he will be beaten, right? You see, a slave works because he has to. An employee works because he needs to, right? You need to go to work even if you don't like to wake up at 6 o'clock or 5 o'clock. You have to go to your office even if you have to drag your feet. You have to punch your body clock, or now modern na ngayon, finger free or iris, face scan, right? You have to do that, otherwise you will not get your salaries, right? But brothers and sisters, the challenge for each and every one of us. But a Christian works because he loves to. Amen? Because a Christian works because he loves to work, right? I am really actually very blessed with how the BBC men works here. Not only, I don't want to commend or uplift any other individuals. Most of the workers you can see or you can find in BBC, they are doing all this, all their efforts out of love. Alam ko marami ang in love, pero iba naman yung mga taga-BBC that they are doing it because they love the Lord. Amen?
Amen.
They are doing, I have seen some, I used to remember Brother Emil, pagdating mo sa church, si Brother Emil ang makikita mo. Pag ulis mo, si Brother Emil pa naman nag-aayos ng parking. Sige, abante. Imagine mo yan, lahat na lang ata na ako ni Brother Emil. We really miss Brother Emil. But same is true with the other men in the church and other ladies. They do a lot of hard works in BBC. I used to remember the preacher, his name is Pastor Rudy De Llosa. He was the preacher that was used by God for me to be saved when I was 14 years old in Bicol. He was a pastor in our very far place, in Magallanes, Sorsogon. You need to drive 12 hours from Manila. You have to imagine that if you will ride in a bus, you sleep 3 times, and when you wake up, are we there? No, not yet. You have to sleep more. Ganun po kalayo yung probinsya namin sa Bicol. But I asked Pastor Rudy one time when I was still a kid, Pastor Rudy, do you get tired of preaching every day in church? Do you get tired of sharing the word of God to the provinces? You need to ride by boat in Bicol, in Magallanes, only to share the word of God? Ganun po kahirap ang ministry sa mga probinsya. Wala po masyado mga sasakyan, mostly lakad lang, tricycle. He told me, I don't get tired, Brother Nia. I don't get tired of preaching the word of God because I love what I'm doing. Amen? The question for us this evening, do you love what you're doing for the Lord? This is labor of love, brothers and sisters. We know that you are tired from work. We know that the world is celebrating Easter Sunday today. But we don't believe that our Lord Jesus Christ is risen today because we know that 2,000 years ago, He already rise from the dead and He is back in heaven.
Amen.
Amen? But the world are celebrating, they're relaxing, they're partying because of this event in the secular world. But we are Christians, we are still coming to church because we know, because we love the Lord. Amen?
Amen.
And third, let us see some second, third some point, the patience of faith. The Bible speaks of the patience of hope in our Lord Jesus Christ. First, the practice of faith. This is the faith, work of faith, the patience of hope. The Bible speaks about the patience of hope in our Lord Jesus Christ. We all need to realize the importance and need for patience in the Lord. Patience, brothers and sisters, is very important in the ministry. Amen? Because you will experience this for a lot of times. You have friends, you share the Word of God, and they say, yes, yes, I like it. How about if you come with me to church? Yes, yes, yes. Tinuagan mo na Friday, yes, that pupunta ka, you coming? Yes, yes, yes. Last minute, well, I have, I need to go to city center, and I need to go somewhere else. We need to go to the beach. And this only happens when you share the Word of God, when you share the Word of God. You understand the message that I shared with you? Yes, yes, yes. Are you going to accept the Lord Jesus Christ? Next time na lang po. Next time. You see, you get the frustrations. But brothers and sisters, we don't need to worry about this when we get rejected. Because it is not us that we are doing this. When I remember when I got saved, I shared the Word of God. I give drugs. Some of them that receive the drugs, they tear it. And they put it in the trash can. I told my pastor, Pastor, why do they do this? Why? Sabi na dito, why like that? Right? Why like that? And my pastor told me, in order for you not to get upset, I will give you a simple illustration. Every time you give drugs, every time you share the Word of God, you have to think like a messenger. Alright? Think like a messenger. But again, what's a messenger? Let's say you work with UPS, work with FedEx, DHL. You're a guy who delivers a gift or a package to someone. When you go to a name, Sister Precious, this is the package for you. You don't care if Sister Precious tear it, throw it in the trash. You don't care. You don't get hurt, right? Because that is your job, right? You don't get the emotion that you get hurt after that, right? After that, I was blessed and I was really challenged by that illustration. So every time I give like a messenger. A messenger that you work for God. You're not a messenger that works with Aramex, but you're a messenger that works for God. Amen?
Amen.
In order for you not to get frustrated, not to get upset. Amen? That's, the Bible says in Galatians chapter 6 verse 9. What does the Bible say in Galatians chapter 6 verse 9? And let us not be weary in well-doing, for in due season we shall reap if we faint not. Moto ko to nung naliligaw ko nung after ko na nung college. Moto ko to eh. Ito yung moto namin sa Antipolo ng mga singles. Let us not be weary daw. Punuhin ko to yung sarili ko ng pag-asa. Right?
Yeah.
Motto ata ito ng mga singles eh. But this is a motto for Christians. Let us not be weary and well-doing, for in due season we shall reap if we faint not. And in Romans chapter 8 verse 25, but if we hope for that we see not, then do we with patience with it. Wait for it. I'm sorry. Amen? And on the second point, we need to be steadfast. We need to be steadfast, brothers and sisters. First is that we need to be serving. We need to prepare for the second coming. We need to be serving. We need to be steadfast. The Bible says in 1 Corinthians chapter 15, verse 58. Can you open the Bible on this passage, please? 1 Corinthians chapter 15, verse 58. The Bible says, therefore, my beloved brethren, be steadfast, unmovable, always abounding in the work of the Lord, for as much as ye know that your labor is not in vain in the Lord. Amen?
Amen.
Brothers and sisters, your efforts, your good works, you're very tired doing this one for the Lord. I was blessed by the transport ministry. If they're already very tired from work, but they have to drop all the brethren that doesn't have car, they need to drop them home before they can go home, and they need to return back the car in Lukta, and they need to go back to industrial area. That is the job of Brother Noel Agmalio before. Full of hard work, and brothers and sisters, no pain. Ang pain nito, isa langit po. Amen? Yung hirap niyo po ngayon, doon niyo po in cash sa langit. Amen? You can get your checks in heaven. We need to be steadfast. The second point, we need to be steadfast. The Thessalonians, brethren, were, we need to be steadfast on your notes. They knew afflictions while serving. The Bible says in 1 Thessalonians chapter 3, verse 3, it says that no man should be moved by these afflictions. Apostle Paul knows that the Thessalonians, brethren, are having afflictions. They're having difficulties, they're having trials, persecution, difficulties in life. They know that they will experience these difficulties while serving the Lord. Amen? And they just don't know, they aside from knowing the afflictions while serving, they also have the joy in spite of suffering. In 1 Thessalonians chapter 3, verse 9, the Bible says, "For what thanks can we render to God again for you, for all the joy, for we rejoice, for your sakes before our God?" In spite of all the difficulties and hardships that the Thessalonians brethren are suffering, they still have the joy. Amen? They still have joy in their hearts, and they continue in serving the Lord. I will give you an example of how to be steadfast. The only example for being steadfast is only Apostle Paul in the Bible. He is the most steadfast individual or apostle I have seen in the Bible. If you will open your Bibles in 2 Corinthians chapter 11, verse 25, can you open it? The Bible says, let's start with 24, "Of the Jews, five times I received 40 stripes, save one." 39 stripes. 39 na palo, mga kapatid. "Thrice was I beaten with rods. Once I was stoned. Thrice I suffered shipwreck. A night and a day I have been in the deep. In journeyings often, in perils of waters, meaning dangers sa tubig, perils of robbers, in perils by mine own countrymen, in perils by the heathen, in perils in the city, in perils in the wilderness, in perils in the sea, in perils among false brethren, in weariness and painfulness, in watching open, in hunger and thirst, in fastings open, in cold and nakedness. Beside those things that are without, that which cometh upon me daily," araw-araw po siyang nahihirapan, "the care of all the churches." In spite of all this, Apostle Paul didn't quit and didn't stop the ministry. Amen? Siguro, one of us, or kahit sino, kahit ako siguro mapalo lang ako, siguro magpapahinga ako ng mga 6 months. If you experience what Apostle Paul is suffering during the early church, I don't think maybe BBC will be all gone. Maybe maubos tayo rito. If you can see the sufferings that he has experienced during his time, maybe there will be no Christians. Amen? Amen? But Apostle Paul, his eyes was focused on the finish line. Amen? His eyes were focused on the Lord Jesus Christ, that he wanted to serve his Creator, his Savior. Amen? So I will give you an example. There was one man. His name is Bob Leland. He was a famous man in New York during how many years back? He was a six foot man, maybe as tall as mine, and 200 pounds, little slimmer than mine. He was a soldier that went to Vietnam War. He was a soldier, an American soldier that went to Vietnam War. He's very strong. He's very courageous. But when he went to Vietnam, he experienced, and he was in a candy, or like a small car, like a Humvee, and they hit a landmine, and the car exploded. And one, he just woke up, Bob Leland woke up, he was in the hospital. And when he woke up, he can't feel his toes. Not just his toes, but he can't feel his knees. When he looked on his knees, he was lying on a bed, and his thighs, his legs were cut. Here on the torso, on the thigh. It was cut. It was amputated, and both of his legs were cut. He got depressed and he went back to the U.S. But this man was a challenge for runners who love to run.
Because this man, not only a man with two amputated legs, but this man ran a marathon. This man ran a marathon. And a normal man, a normal runner can run a marathon for about 4 hours, Brother Gary, right? 3 hours for some 2 hours to 3 hours for Olympic timings. For a normal man, you can run it for 4 hours to 5 hours, I guess. But this man ran the New York Marathon. You want to know how? How long? He ran the New York Marathon for 98 hours, 47 minutes, and 17 seconds. It's almost 3 to 4 days he did this running. This is a classic example of steadfastness. It doesn't matter if you don't have legs, you have prosthetic legs. But he was so determined that he was determined to finish the marathon that in spite of his condition, he ran the marathon in almost 3 to 4 days. Amen? Let us use this as an example as Christians that we need to be steadfast in serving the Lord. Amen? And the third point I want to share with you this evening is that we need to be sharing. We need not to be sharing your food, we need not to be sharing your cash, but we need to be sharing the Word of God. Amen?
Amen.
In Mark 16 verse 15, the Bible says, Mark 16 verse 15, the Bible says, what does the Bible says in Mark 16 verse 15? Can you show it, please? And he said unto them, go ye into all the world and preach the gospel to every creature. Go and share the word of God to every creature. Amen?
Amen.
And the first sub-point I want to share with you concerning sharing is that the Thessalonians brethren were examples of soul winning. They were examples. They are not only walking the talk, but they are doing the talk. They are example of soul winning. If we believe Jesus is coming, we need to be involved in soul winning.
Amen.
Right? You need to share the word of God. If you are silent for how many years, if you believe that the Lord Jesus Christ is coming soon, you have to start sharing the word of God to your loved ones. Start with your loved ones. If they don't listen, go to your friends. If they don't listen, continue sharing. Use the social media to share the word of God, but you have to be very cunning on it. You have to be very discreet on it. Amen? Brother Ian told me to share the word of God, then I will share the word of God. But you have to be discreet and very cunning and very silly to do it. You have to be wise because, you know, in this country, it is not safe to do it like what you want to say, you know? You have to use some art and skills to share the word of God, not to compromise your safety as well. Amen?
Amen?
You have to share and be an example of the word of God. The Bible says in 1 Thessalonians 1:17, this the Bible says, so that ye were examples to all that believe in Macedonia and Achaia. The Thessalonians, brethren, are examples. Same like us, BBC, we need to be an example. We need to show how to share the word of God. Amen? In order for the new believers to share the word of God, it should start from us. We need to start sharing the word of God, and they should follow later on. Amen?
Amen.
We need to be a model first. We need to be an example. And not only the Thessalonian brethren are examples, they also their evidence of soul winning. Not they only share the word of God, not they only show the word of God, but they produce results in sharing the word of God. The Bible says in Acts chapter 2 verse 41, can you show this Acts chapter 2 verse 41? Then that they are gladly received his word were baptized, and the same day there were added unto them about 3,000 souls. Imagine, brothers and sisters, during the early times, when they preached, thousands were saved. Amen? Imagine just one soul, there are thousands of angels are rejoicing in heaven. How much more about 3,000 souls? Amen? So keep on sharing the word of God and keep on preaching the word of God. I will tell you one story. I know you love to listen to stories. This story was about D.L. Moody. Do you know about D.L. Moody? These are the classic preachers. This happens around 100 years ago. And in Indianapolis, there was like a convention for pastors. In front of the convention center in Indianapolis, they are preachers, missionaries, teachers, and they were teaching how to preach the Word of God. Amen? Like conventions, like for BBC, we have a workshop. We practice how to preach the Word of God. We practice how to teach the Word of God. But on this part, while they are doing the preaching inside the convention center in Indianapolis, there was one man outside the convention center who was preaching the Word of God. He was preaching, he was sharing the Word of God, and then the head of the convention go out and told him, while the preacher and parishioners were inside the auditorium, the evangelist outside on the street corner was preaching the Word of God. That this man was D.L. Moody. He was preaching. While he was preaching, the guy inside the convention go outside and tell him, "Brother, can you please just go out? Move a little further, like 1 to 2 blocks, so that you will not disturb what we're doing inside the convention." So, what D.L. Moody did, what he just moved 2 blocks away. While those who on the inside talk about soul winning, D.L. Moody on the outside was doing it. Amen? While they were learning how to preach, there was one man outside the convention. He's not learning how to do it. He was actually doing it. He was actually doing the preaching. Amen?
Amen.
We are not being encouraged to preach on the streets because there's a right place where to preach the Word of God. But what is the Bible and what we are telling is that we need to preach. Amen? We need to share the Word of God and use to be decisive and be discreet on how you are going to share the Word of God. Not to compromise or not to jeopardize your safety and your while you we are here for work. We need to protect it also. Amen? And the fourth point is that we need to be separate. We need to be separated. In 1 Thessalonians 1 verse 9, the Bible says, 1 Thessalonians 1 verse 9, what does the Bible say about this? The Bible says, "For they themselves show us what manner of entering in we had unto you, and how ye turned from God, from idols, and to serve the living and true God." Brothers and sisters, the one I want to share with you this evening, this is about idolatry. Whether you like it or not, idolatry is being practiced and being alive in the world today. If you are going back, if you will remember your relatives in the Philippines, this time was the time in the Philippines where all the saints were being, procession. They do some procession and they bring the saints on the road, and they pray, and they wipe their towels and their handkerchiefs, and they pray, right? This is idolatry. These things were idolatry. But, Brother Ian, I don't worship idols. I don't worship idols. But being idols, this it doesn't only comes in the worshiping of a wooden statue. Idolatry and idols comes in various forms. It comes with any activity that hinders your performance in serving our living God. Amen? If you are very concerned about your work, you have idols. If you are concerned and you love your family more than God, that is idolatry. You are idolizing your family more than God. If you idolize your health, your sports more than God, that's idolatry. Because anything that you like and you love doing most instead of doing it for the Lord, that's idolatry. If you spend more time in your gadgets rather than spending more time in your Bibles, that's idolatry. Because you are not supposed to spend more time on those gadgets if that is hindering you from reading the Word of God. Honestly, I will ask you one question. How many hours do you spend time in your gadgets? The truth. Yung totoo lang po. Kasi even myself, I spend more hours in my gadget. And I am really convicted of this. And I admit it that it is my fault. Instead of spending it reading the Bible, I spend it on the TV, on my mobile, on my laptop, on my computer. Right? What I'm sharing this morning, this evening, is that baka magalit kayo sa akin, no? I'm telling this because this is what the Word of God is telling us. We need to stop doing things that are removing our time, that are consuming our time from the Lord. Amen? We need to be separate. The Thessalonians brethren are sure of the will of God. They are sure of the will of God. We are not going to dwell more on the verses. I have put the verses there in your notes so that you can study it and read it once you go to your houses. You can meditate on it. The Thessalonians know that they have a right relationship with God. We don't need to be doubting Christians, but we need to be shouting Christians. They know the will of God. We need to know that all sins are under the blood and that we are knowledgeable and obedient to the will of God. Actually, brothers and sisters, it is very difficult to succumb to the will of God. Because sometimes the will of God is not on our will, right? Sometimes we want to do this, but this is not the will of God. But we have to succumb on the will of God. There's a lot of passages in the Bible that tells that we need to obey the will of God. Sometimes we tell that, brother, you have to obey the will of God. The reality, do we really obey the will of God? That's a challenge for us. And the Thessalonian brethren in the early church, they say they were sure of the word of God. They are sure. In 1 Thessalonians 1:5, the Bible says, "For our gospel came not unto you in the word only, but also in power and in assurance of the Holy Ghost and in assurance as you know that the manner of men we were among you for you to sing." They were sure of the word of God. Alam po nila na ang true word of God is going to change hearts and lives. Amen? And the third point, the third sub-point, they were sure of the witness of God. I will give you an example in 1 John 1:12-13. The Bible says, 1 John 1:10, this is about the Father and Son relationship. This is about the Father and Son relationship. I will just tell you one example. During the time of President Lincoln in the White House, he was a very busy man. He was the President of the United States. He was having a meeting in the Oval Office. Then suddenly, his eldest son, Todd, was playing on the other room. And then when his son was playing, his toy was broken. He was having a meeting with all of his cabinet secretaries. When suddenly, the son was playing in a toy car, and it was broken. So the son, he didn't care. He don't think about other things. He just went straight into the office, and he go to his dad and says, "Dad, can you please fix the toy?" And all the cabinet secretaries were shocked. They were waiting for what does President Lincoln is going to do. What does President Lincoln do was that he didn't tell his son to go back, go to your room and tell your mom to fix it. What he did was he take his son, he put it in his lap, and he fixed the toy car. Brothers and sisters, this is a normal reaction on a father and son relationship. A son should not be scared to come to his father. Amen? This is the privilege that God gave us. When you accepted the Lord Jesus Christ as our Lord and personal Savior, we can go directly to the Lord Jesus Christ and confess our sins, pray for Him, ask Him whatever we want, and ask Him whatever we need. Amen? We have a privilege that God gave us. We are sons and daughters. The Bible says we are sons and daughters. Amen? We're not going to dive on the verses because we need more time. And on the fifth point is that we need to be saved. All the points I shared with you that we need to be serving, we need to be steadfast, we need to be sharing, we need to be separate, will all be useless if we are not saved. All of those things that we can do for the Lord to prepare us for the second coming will all be useless if we are not saved. The Bible says in Ephesians 2:8-9, "For by grace are ye saved." And that there is, on the sub-point of this one is that there are aspects of salvation. And this Apostle Paul gives these aspects of salvation. The first sub-point I want to share with you is the source of our salvation. The source of our salvation is Ephesians 2:8-9. we are only saved by the grace of God. Amen?
Amen?
We are not worthy to be saved, but it is only made possible by the grace of God. Amen? And not only this, we have the satisfaction of salvation. If you are going to study the book of most of the writings of Apostle Paul, you can easily find on these verses that I wrote there, 1 Corinthians 1:3, 2 Corinthians 1:2, Galatians 1:3, Ephesians 1:2, Philippians 1:2. Most of these verses, he says, grace and peace. Grace and peace. You can't have peace without grace, brothers and sisters. This works hand in hand. It goes together. You cannot separate this one. Because grace follows, peace follows on the heels of grace. Amen? Para po itong nanay at bata, kung asa pumunta yung nanay, nakikita niyo yung bata, susunod sa nanay niya. Para po itong magkadikit. Amen? Grace is very important because you cannot have peace without grace. Amen? That's why on the book, on the writings of Apostle Paul, he always mentions grace and peace. And on the third sub-point is the strength of salvation. We are now in Jesus. If you have the Lord Jesus Christ as your Lord and personal Savior, we have a new position. We are called sons and daughters. Amen? In 1 John 1:12, 1 John 3:1, we are called sons and daughters. We are adopted sons of God. Amen? And not only that, we have a new position. We have also new possessions. Not position, I'm sorry, position and possessions. What is your new possession, brothers and sisters? Your new possessions is that when we are all finished here and when our Lord Jesus Christ comes tonight or in the future, wherein we are waiting, we are excitedly waiting for His return, is that we are going to heaven. Amen? We are going with Him. The Bible says where our Lord Jesus Christ is, there you may be also. Amen? Amen? And the privilege that we have, not only we have a new position, that we are called sons and daughters, we have a new possessions, God gave us heaven, we have privilege, we have the direct access to our Lord Jesus Christ. Amen? In John 14:6, we can now go boldly unto the throne of grace. And the second sub-point is that the plan of salvation. This is my most favorite verse, John 3:16. For God so loved the world that He gave His only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth on Him should not perish, but have everlasting life. Amen?
Amen.
The plan of salvation, during the time of Isaac, Abraham, and Isaac, there is one lamb for one man. And Genesis chapter 22, verse 13, God instructed Abraham to offer your son in the mountain. Amen? But when he was there and when Abraham was about to strike and he was about to hit Isaac, God provided a lamb. Amen?
Amen.
This is an illustration that our Lord Jesus Christ was the lamb that was being provided. But during the old times, when a man would sin, each man had to offer up his own lamb for the covering of his sin. Amen? And after that, one lamb for one family. This happens in the Passover in Egypt. This happens when all the firstborn in the land were killed. In Exodus chapter 12, verse 47, you can read it later on. And lastly, one lamb for the whole world. This is our Lord Jesus Christ. In John 1:29 and John 3:16. Amen? And lastly, for our conclusion, how to prepare for the second coming of our Lord Jesus Christ? We need to be serving. We need to be steadfast. We need to be sharing. And we need to be separate. And lastly, the most important of all, we need to be saved. All these things will be useless if we are not saved.
Amen? So, I just hope and pray, brothers and sisters, that Christianity is a warfare. We are in serious battle for the souls of men. And a message from our captain, our Lord Jesus Christ, that He is coming very soon. If we are going to be ready when He comes again, we have to be saved, sure, serving, steadfast, soul-winning, and separated. Amen. Let us pray. Our most gracious and heavenly Father, thank you so much for your message. We pray that you grant us understanding.